Despite repeated BIS interventions, China plans to send the price of gold skyrocketing today. One of the greats in the business says that despite repeated interventions by the BIS to halt gold's advance, China plans to send the price of gold skyrocketing. China plans to send gold prices soaring December 3, King World News, DR. Stephen Lieb, when you write a PhD dissertation, before you re-awarded your degree, you go before a panel of professors who grill you about your work. If you can't defend your arguments well enough, answering every counterpoint your questioners, tormentors, raise, you can't say goodbye to putting a doctor before your name. It's a nerve-wracking test, but it's also useful. If you can't answer reasonable questions convincingly, maybe your case isn't so strong after all. I've been making the case that gold is on the threshold of a sustained bull market. In a nutshell, my case centers on China. In the past decade and a half, China has surpassed the US as the biggest global trader. China, which, like the rest of the world, got burned by the 2008 US financial crisis, is leery of the dollar. It wants an international monetary system that isn't dependent on the dollar, or any paper currency for that matter. China has a deep abiding faith in gold, and has been accumulating gold, as it anticipates bringing about a monetary system, in which gold will be an integral part. Implementation of such a system will be one reason gold will soar, another will be growing resource scarcities. These, too, relate to China's rise, as the country continues to spur creation of huge amounts of infrastructure throughout the East, including in China itself. That's my thesis in its simplest form. If I had to defend it before a panel of skeptical and learned inquisitors, how would they try to undermine it? And how would I answer their questions? It so happens that I recently ran into someone who, while interested in the idea of a bull market in gold, also was skeptical. He asked some good questions. His first question: if China has been buying up so much gold, why haven't gold prices been shooting up already? Doesn't this mean there also are sellers of gold? What reason is there to expect that at some point China's demand will push prices higher? His second question: why expect a major paradigm shift, where everyone suddenly will be less willing to trust dollars as a form of exchange, and will want to know a currency has some sort of gold backing? After all, this skeptic points out, currencies have long been abstractions. They work because people have faith in the system that issues them. People today are willing to accept a $20 bill not because they expect to march to Fort Knox and exchange it for gold, but because they believe the US will be around for a long time, and that its cash will be good. Why doubt this will continue? As I said, good questions. Let us start with the first: why hasn't gold been soaring if China has been buying so much? At the start of 2002, gold was trading in the mid-$200s. It made a high of $1,920 in 2011, and then corrected by about 15%. It continued to trade at around $1,600 in 2012, and the first quarter of 2013. Then two major falls, in April 2013 and June 2013, left gold near $1,200. This is around the midpoint of the $1,050-$1,400 trading range that has persisted over the past 4 years. The BIS intervenes. I see two factors accounting for gold stagnating over the past 5 years. First, in 2013, the Bank for International Settlements, BIS, issued a set of rules designed to prevent the kind of financial debacle that had rocked the world in 2008. The rules mandated that banks hold a healthy percentage of liquid assets, and they listed the assets that would count towards this quota. But notably, and against all expectations, they omitted gold, even though gold had outperformed the dollar, U.S. bonds, and other assets during the crash. It was a remarkable omission. It is not a stretch to interpret the BIS's action as a deliberate effort to protect the dollar's position as the world's reserve currency, especially given some pushback against the dollar that had emerged after 2008. Specifically, in 2009, Zhu Xiaochuan, head of China's central bank, the People's Bank of China, had urged international financial institutions to consider dropping the dollar and replacing it with some combination of SDRs and gold. So the idea had been rooted, and perhaps the BIS felt it needed to shoot it down. Regardless of its motive, leaving gold off the menu of liquid assets was one big reason that gold dropped in 2013. The second cause was the global economic slowdown. Until recently, despite efforts across the globe, world growth has been anemic. Even after the recent pickup, many vital statistics remain well shy of previous highs, and even below levels reached in 2007. This is true despite recent headlines trumpeting large gains in real median income in the U.S. that seemingly suggest living standards here have reached new highs. The key word is seemingly. Yes, there have been gains. But in 2014, the Census Bureau, which calculates this key measure, threw out its old methodology and adopted another system. That's okay, except that it failed to apply its new techniques to past data, so it failed to compare oranges with oranges. When you do, i.e. when you apply the new rules to pre-2014 data, it turns out that living standards are far short of previous highs in the last century as well as the 2007 peak. Other statistics further support the idea that U.S. living standards have been losing ground. To cite just two, homeownership has been slipping relative to the numbers of people who rent, and a rising percentage of car purchases are of used, not new, cars. The tie to gold, and to why gold prices haven't yet taken off, is that sluggish economic growth has meant sluggish growth in commodity prices. While some measures of commodity prices have equaled or topped 2008 levels, so far virtually all indexes remain shy of 2011 all-time highs. That's relevant because gold is closely linked to prices in commodities. Pre-2008, when commodities were flying, gold was soaring higher. And in 2011, when commodities and gold both made tops, the gain in gold since 2002 was twice the gains made by major commodity indexes. That performance echoed the 1970s, when as commodities soared, gold rose by a lot more. And this makes sense. The tendency of gold to outperform soaring commodities is a logical reaction to potential commodity scarcities that higher commodity prices signal. Given the above two factors, the BIS's move to minimize gold's role as a currency and sluggish growth in commodities, it is not surprising that gold has flatlined despite heavy Chinese buying. The world produces about 3,000 tons of gold a year. It is estimated that China purchases somewhere between 1,500 and 2,000 tons a year. Gold has few industrial uses, meaning it doesn't get used up and is never scarce for economic reasons. It is likely that under the conditions that have prevailed since 2011, the Chinese could purchase as much as 4,000 tons a year without affecting prices much, as holders of the metal would likely be willing to sell. Now for my skeptical friend, a second question: why think that anything will really change, dethroning the US dollar? After all, as he points out, the US still has tons of resources and makes lots of things. We're not going anywhere. So why can't the dollar just keep on going as the world's major reserve currency? Here I think my friend is a bit blind or ostrich-like in not seeing how much China's emergence threatens to upend existing international norms. The world really did start new at the end of 2001 when China entered the World Trade Organization, WTO. China abruptly gained the ability for immensely larger trade with other countries. This has redefined the world's economy. By an ever-growing margin, China has replaced the US as the world's largest trader. Imports plus exports. Equally important, if you measure a country's GDP in international dollars, China has surpassed the US as the world's biggest economy and continues to widen its lead. About two centuries of Western, European, and American economic leadership have been toppled in the first decade and half of this century. An additional relevant comparison is that between 1990 and 1994, about 63% of world trade took place among developed countries. Over the past 5 years, more than 63% of world trade involves developing nations, with China by far the most important contributor. Clearly, economic trends in the developing world have become far more important than trends in the developed world. The point is that China holds more and more of the cards. It will have an increasing ability to get its way and get what it wants, at a minimum within the eastern part of the world, which will be accounting for the lion's share of world growth. And what China wants is a revamped monetary system that downplays the dollar and emphasizes gold. It will be exerting pressure to achieve this, and we expect its efforts will succeed. Elevating gold as a currency will, in effect, undo what the BIS did to gold in 2013. At the same time, we expect that commodities have made a bottom and will be rising, perhaps sharply. The factors that have kept gold listless will now start to propel gold dramatically higher. I could say a lot more here. I could cite, once again, China's Song Zhen, who said that gold's strategic mission is to support the internationalization of the renminbi and be a strong support for realizing the Chinese dream. I could note that, while Warren Buffett says America has been around for 250 years, China has been around for 3,000 years, and in all but two of those 30 centuries has been the world's top economy. And I could again discuss how a yuan/gold-backed Eastern oil contract will likely be launched in the very near future and lead to other commodities being traded in a gold-backed yuan, the initial steps to a new monetary system. Countdown to a massive breakout in gold has begun. Above all, I could again note that China sits at the center of the developing world, an aggregation of nearly 6.5 billion people, whose per capita GDP is well under $8,000, or one-fifth that of the higher-income countries. China intends to reach levels closer to Western standards of living, and to take much of the developing world along with it. That goal implies a nearly unimaginable level of future demand for commodities. No wonder China has made sure it controls a vast array of critical commodities, from cobalt to lithium to heavy rare earths, and has massive stockpiles of others, including oil, silver, and copper. And against most Wall Street expectations, it continues to add to these stockpiles. In sum, the conditions for rising commodities and a new monetary system are falling into place, and the countdown to a massive breakout in gold has begun. Speaking of gold in the footsteps of giants, one of the top questions KWN receives from investors about the mining industry is always, how do you know out of the thousands of companies there are to choose from which will take off and which ones will falter? The answer for smart money investors is always to look for proven leaders with previous success as a good indicator of future success. One individual that fits this description is pictured below with multi-billionaire Robert Friedland. Multi-billionaire Robert Friedland chose this man to lead his exploration team, and it turned out to be a brilliant move because he was responsible for two of the largest and most important discoveries the world has ever seen while leading the team at Ivanhoe Mines. Investors across the globe are now following this man into his latest venture, where he will help lead an exploration team, where the CEO believes the team will deliver drill results that will send the stock price soaring. China plans to send gold prices soaring December 3, King World News, DR. Stephen Lieb, when you write a PhD dissertation, before you re-awarded your degree, you go before a panel of professors who grill you about your work. If you can't defend your arguments well enough, answering every counterpoint your questioners, tormentors, raise, you can't say goodbye to putting a doctor before your name. It's a nerve-wracking test, but it's also useful. If you can't answer reasonable questions convincingly, maybe your case isn't so strong after all. I've been making the case that gold is on the threshold of a sustained bull market. In a nutshell, my case centers on China. In the past decade and a half, China has surpassed the US as the biggest global trader. China, which, like the rest of the world, got burned by the 2008 US financial crisis, is leery of the dollar. It wants an international monetary system that isn't dependent on the dollar, or any paper currency for that matter. China has a deep abiding faith in gold, and has been accumulating gold, as it anticipates bringing about a monetary system, in which gold will be an integral part. Implementation of such a system will be one reason gold will soar, another will be growing resource scarcities. These, too, relate to China's rise, as the country continues to spur creation of huge amounts of infrastructure throughout the East, including in China itself. That's my thesis in its simplest form. If I had to defend it before a panel of skeptical and learned inquisitors, how would they try to undermine it? And how would I answer their questions? It so happens that I recently ran into someone who, while interested in the idea of a bull market in gold, also was skeptical. He asked some good questions. His first question: if China has been buying up so much gold, why haven't gold prices been shooting up already? Doesn't this mean there also are sellers of gold? What reason is there to expect that? Despite repeated BIS interventions, China plans to send the price of gold skyrocketing. Today, one of the greats in the business says that despite repeated interventions by the BIS to halt gold's advance, China plans to send the price of gold skyrocketing.